Welcome to Physio TV. Today we have Dr. Alap Javadekar, our very own Olympic medalist physiotherapist. So I would want to call the silver medal physiotherapist as of now. So I understand it has been a very exhilarating journey from being just a physical therapist to patients, then moving towards athletes, then training them, being a part of their core team. For their training, for their well-being during the whole tournament and even the pre-training or the pre-tournament training, whatever was done. So introducing Dr. Alap Javadekar again, he is a senior physiotherapist for Olympic Gold Quest for India. He began from April 2015 and still continuing it. So as a part of the assignment of the OGQ, that is the Olympic Gold Quest, he's currently working with Mirabai Chanu, who has been awarded the silver medal for weightlifting. And again, it is just one of the laurels we have been having in the Olympics right now. So again, she was in the 49 kg weight category, right? So, So again, getting a little background on Dr. Javadekar. He did his master's from University of South Australia in 2013 for sports physiotherapy. His bachelor's is from Myers College of Physiotherapy, Talegaon, very close to Pune, which was affiliated to Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. Yeah. Then off to you, Dr. Javadekar, I want you to give out some experiences that you've been had when you were a UG. How did it follow through with your physiotherapy graduation, then your post-graduation as well?
Yeah, so what, thank you for the warm introduction. And I think the firstly, I would want to say that, you know, the silver medal physio and all is great to hear, but it's too overwhelming, to be honest. And it's nothing that we've done so much. It's entirely Mirabai's credit, and what she has put in over the years has just culminated into this wonderful achievement for her, and we're very, very proud and honored and privileged to be a part of her journey in some manner. So the silver medal part is we're all celebrating. That's what we are. And now coming back to a little bit of me. So I started physiotherapy. It's like 2007. I got into the college at Talegaon. I didn't want to ever. I was like, my parents are from the medicine background. So I had to get into some kind of medicine, but I didn't want to get into emergency medicine because I had seen while, you know, growing up years or childhood days, I had seen that, my father used to get emergency calls when we were about to go to the movies or, you know, something like that. So it was a categoric decision that I didn't want to get into any emergency medicine line. And physiotherapy was that for me, and I did not understand the M of mathematics, so I had to choose anything to biology that was connected to biology, and it sort of naturally came to me a little bit through medicine that was happening in the family. And I loved sports, so I was a table tennis player in school. I used to swim a little bit, and it sort of was a part of, and I was a big and still is a big fan of cricket, used to keep watching a lot of cricket on TV. And between overs of when there was some issue with someone, the guy would keep running into the field with a little bag in his hand, always made me curious, and more so curious because there would usually be an ad break at the time when someone would run in, and I would keep thinking, what is he doing to this player that's sort of fallen down or has got hurt, and suddenly after the ad break, all we could see was the guy running back, and then the player was ready to play. So it sort of got me curious I was very inclined towards following that up, and then I got into physiotherapy, and then from there sports was always the first choice. So I knew that I had to sort of plan my master's for sports and musculoskeletal obviously being the parent field for sports. And then I knew that I had to go out, otherwise at that time there were not many programs in the country that would offer that kind of education. And it was again a very planned decision to go out. We planned for it as a family, you know, financially and everything. And then I was lucky to have had a chance to go to Australia and, you know, study there. And that was really, really very special. Obviously, at Taregaon, my foundation was laid very well. I had some very basic good coaching of physiotherapy there. And after that, like the basics were clear. And then when I went into the master's program, it was really another level of education. I had to really match up to that. It was initially difficult, but once you get through it, it was really very rewarding. And the professors there were really, really good. They were the disciples of all we, I mean, disciples as in, they come from the same school of thought of Maitland. So it was really nice to sort of, you know, work with the stalwarts in the field and learn from them. And that was a massively learning experience. After that, I decided to work for a year in Australia. So as part of the course itself, we had a lot of exposure to the Australian rules football and teams. And after that, I worked at a small practice in a distant village. But then, because I was in a small practice, I could do a lot of things. I could go out and, you know, work with clubs, even play some cricket. That gave me a lot of exposure in sports, and you could sort of see differences between what we do versus what they do, and you could compare. And then there was a conscious thought of not staying back there for too long, and, you know, the agenda of working there was for just about a year or two, and then learn from them, consolidate what we've learned, and come back and see if I could get any opportunities here. And luckily, it so happened that 2015, that was by the time I sort of completed my year and a half in Australia, about two years. Late towards 2014, I got to know that there was an opportunity in OGQ with the Indian boxing team. Mm-hmm. And I was straight from literally Australia to Patiala. I traveled.
Oh.
So it was like and I was with the national boxing team, and you couldn't have asked for anything better. Especially I was literally like raring to go at that point of time. It was like a golden opportunity at the age of 25 mm-hmm. to work with the elite boxers of the country. Mm-hmm. So I prepared, that was a massive learning experience again. It was not easy, but like in sport, it's never easy. It's always challenging as much mm-hmm. as it is for the athletes. It is for the support staff as well. So then I was with OGQ, then I worked with the boxers for till Rio Olympics. I didn't travel to the Olympics, but I was very much involved till the last day that Shiva Thapa flew. I mean, I was working with boxers at that point of time.
Hmm.
And then slowly I got into shooting, because OGQ keeps supporting a lot of sports. So then moved to shooting, then slowly to archery, then again back to shooting, then archery. So it sort of came in between there was a little bit of boxing again, some badminton in between, and then I was back to I got into weightlifting. And actually it just came to me, the opportunity, through OGQ early January this year, and it was a very short stint actually, but still you know, Mirabai at that time was left without a physiotherapist because her physiotherapist had to move suddenly because of his personal reasons. And therefore, I had to step in, and it was a really, really massive learning experience again, because it was very challenging to come in and work with an Olympic-bound athlete at that level in a sport which requires heavy physiotherapy stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was very intense, very challenging, but equally rewarding. I think I've spoken a lot.
No, that's still fine. I mean, you can still go on and on, and we'll still listen to all of the stories.
Yeah, so that's it. I mean, that's how I got into weightlifting eventually. Like, I just...
Yes. So from being a physiotherapy undergrad to being a physiotherapist to an Olympic silver medalist. Yeah. Yes, that's been a long journey, and we surely know that it would have taken a lot of efforts to you to have to come to that level to be, I mean... to be of that caliber that actually people go for all of this.
It's challenging. I mean, there's nothing like you become that, you know, you become of that caliber. It's not like, I mean, you just do what is required for the athlete, and that's just the simple way to sort of keep doing it again and again. And it sounds simple. It's not simple. You have to keep doing it, like keep working towards every single thing that the athlete needs. and the athletes and the coaches and the entire ecosystem of the athletes, just because of the nature of the, you know, the competitiveness of that field, keep you on your toes all the time. So that's just how it is. And it's good to be on your toes.
Yeah. So it's just that we can just imagine of, for example, if we have been to an intercollegiate tournament, we understand the whole experience of all the athletes together, being together under one's roof in a stadium. So that itself is quite exhilarating. So it still happened late. The Olympics that we were expecting was supposed to be 2020. Again, that did not happen. But again, Tokyo Olympics 2020 still happened. Better late than never. So being amongst the top athletes and their multidisciplinary teams, their coaches and everything, how was your experience? How did it feel to be amongst them?
Oh, it was a surreal experience. There's nothing, I mean, I can't describe it in words. I'm short of words. It was every single day. Firstly, I mean, there were so many aspects to that experience, you know. One, the first being that you are part of this elite club, so to say. And I mean, in a way, I'm not saying elite club to be sort of like, you know, I was an elite over there. Nothing like that. It's just that you sort of admire and you're in awe of that kind of an atmosphere. And just to give an example, I mean, you land there. I mean, you're so much in the zone of doing what you have to do that you suddenly realize when you are in that, oh, actually I'm in here. And this is where all eyes of the world are right now. And even if there's one COVID positive case in the village, it'll go around the entire world and everyone will be talking about it. And then you sort of realize that, oh my God, I'm right in the thick of the action. And that's when it sort of hit me, when I was actually there, that, oh, this is unreal and it's unbelievable. And then after that, you know, you get back again to doing what you have to do because that's what you're there for. And then you, again, I mean, just an example, you go to the gym just as a matter of usual training programs. And, you know, you have the training was planned for 4 p.m. in the afternoon. You went to the gym and you suddenly realize that you are in the most aesthetically beautiful gym in the world right now. Because, I mean, the reason I say that, all the latest equipments that, you know, Techno Gym had to offer because they are the brand ambassadors for the Olympic Games. Yes. They were there in the entire sort of massive gymnasium. And you've got the best athletes in the world in their best shape training for their events. And you get to see all of that. And it was just like, it's a massive conference of a kind for the sports enthusiasts, if you look at it that way. So it was, I mean, unbelievable. I can't compare that experience with anything else.
Yes. So again, it would have been a pinch me moment for you. Absolutely. The moment you would have entered.
I mean, it's still like, I'll just to elaborate on this. I our event was on the 24th, like Meera's event was on the 24th, and I was with weightlifting team only. So we, as part of this COVID protocol, you know, entire pandemic affected, if I may say, Olympics, we had to leave within 48 hours of completion of our events. So we were back home on the 27th of July. And the Olympics were almost, I mean, just starting off. They were just starting off. So I actually saw most of the events from my home. And when I came back home to switch the TV on and, you know, I was watching everything else on the phone or on the TV, it looked so weird because 4 or 5 days, you know, before, when I was actually seeing, say, for example, I worked with the archers, I was seeing them. I had met them over there, but watching their matches from home, some suddenly felt like, you know, I was completely on the other spectrum of where I was. And then that's why it actually felt like, was I really there? You know, I was actually there and then I came back. And so it was indeed that kind of a
thing. Yes. So it was like overnight the tables have turned and now you're on the viewer side.
Yes.
So again, it was very different because you would that athletes especially would not have got the chance to acclimatize to the weather that they were supposed to. Like any tournament goes, they are called in early so that they adjust with the weather and everything. So again, because of the precautions that has been taken now, even the athletes might not have got the time to actually have acclimatized. Again, I don't think weightlifting as such is going to be that much bothered by the environmental conditions.
at that level, anything can bother you, to be honest, because it's literally like everyone skill wise is at the same level. All these things, minute things, can make that 1% change in your performance, and then that's all that matters between a bronze medal or fourth position. And
yes,
we all know that fourth positions are for fourth positions, and bronze medal is a bronze medal. So then that's the difference. That's why, I mean, we came in from the US. We were training in the US, and we directly had to fly in from the US, because in India they were like, they had put in a lot of restrictions for us, for the people who were traveling from India. Everyone had to go through 7 days of testing before traveling, and all sorts of, you know, quarantine. There was supposed to be a quarantine after. So we didn't want to risk it. We were already in the US, so we decided, you know, to travel directly from the US to Tokyo, and which meant we had about 14 hours of jet lag to deal with.
Yeah.
And like, we all know that, you know, the circadian rhythms have to be really, really in good shape for the body to really function at its optimum levels physiologically. And so that was a challenge. And at the end of the day, all these challenges were there. But then I, from my personal learning from this experience, was that if the athlete really, really wants it, like really badly wants it, the athlete will do anything for it to happen. And that's just my personal learning experience from this, that, you know, you could do anything that you had to do, but eventually it's the athlete at the end of the day on the podium or on the platform wanting, how badly that athlete wants it at that moment will decide he or she will be able to put in that performance that they want.
So as leading to my next question now, so as an athlete, the athletes itself requires a proper interdisciplinary team, so which is going to have a sports medicine specialist, which is going to include the coach himself or herself, and a physiotherapist. Then you are supposed to have a sports psychologist as well. Right. Though in India, we don't give so much of importance, but again, maybe if we don't have a psychologist with us, I guess it is the duty of all other team members, that the physiotherapist, the sports medicine expert, the coach themselves try to talk to the athlete, try to get their mental ability to the optimum so that they can perform well. Yeah. So do you think even you had to play a role in that for Mirabai?
Actually, it's very interesting. Everybody has to play their part. It's not like, and including obviously the most important is our athlete and the coach. And with Meera, I mean, she's been training under the same coach for a long time, and their relationship is very, very special. I've just put in that word, those words, because they don't really need to talk a lot or even talk at all to communicate. It's just very simple. In fact, on training days, whether the training is going good or bad, there's very little talking involved. All of us don't really, like, we know what we have to do. There's not much talking around. You just go, you do what you have to do, and observe, and that's it. I mean, observation becomes a part of what you do. So therefore, it's essentially just go to the training, do what you have to do, and come back. And then happens a lot of talking, and otherwise, you know, we joke around or whatever we do. That's just sort of, it doesn't quite happen in the training hours. So coming back to what you said, you know, you all of you have to do the part. And in case of Meera's team, they were, I mean, not physically present, but she had a nutritionist on board, she had a psychologist on board, and all of them were working with her from a decently long time, and all played their part in, I mean, that's what you need. You need you need a multidisciplinary approach for something like this. And it, like, internationally, the competition is so fierce now that it's beyond just the athlete. Even if the athlete is an immensely gifted athlete, it's beyond just the athlete putting the show. He or she will need these people around them, around him or her, to, you know, enable her to perform to her best or his best. So you need that. You need the team.
So there goes a lot of teamwork with all these specialists. As you mentioned, even the nutritionist. And yes, the performance is by the athlete, but these are like pillars of strength for the athlete so that they can actually...
So just to again, sorry to interrupt you, but just...
No problem.
Because you asked something about whether you do a lot of other work. It's a little bit of a mix of both. I mean, we are not qualified to be psychologists. Like, if I can talk for myself, like, I'm a physio, I'm not qualified to be a psychologist. So there are specific things that a psychologist would do. And I wouldn't even want to talk about it. But, you know, because I'm not qualified to talk about it.
Yes.
But all you can do is keep, through your actions and your intentions, keep the athlete in the positive space of mind. And obviously, it depends a lot on the athlete. If the athlete wants to be in, again, the positive state of mind, he or she will be in the positive state of mind no matter what. But as a teammate of the athlete, it's your job to do that. It's your job to put in your work the best that you can without sort of asking questions about why I'm doing it, whether it is right, wrong. If it is beneficial for the athlete, you do it for the athlete. It's very simple. And it's almost like war over there, you know. There's nothing right or wrong. I mean, you can keep debating about things that are right or wrong later or in theory books. But on the practical field, when it actually matters, there's nothing right or wrong. If it's right for your athlete, it's right. So a certain K-tape, whether 100% stretch, 80% stretch, this way, that way, it doesn't matter. I'm being point blank about this. It might be controversial to talk about such things, but here it's like a single case study. You are working for that one athlete. And even if you're working for a group of athletes, at that point of time, you're only working for that athlete. And if that one athlete likes what you're doing or likes a certain thing done a certain way, then you do it for that athlete the way he wants it or she wants it. Over a large period of time, you may want to talk about a few things that you can change or do, but especially such close to an Olympic game or just right there, you just go in and do what you have to do for the athlete. And everybody does their bit. The least there is an overlap, the better. Because it's like, we call it teamwork, but if everyone does their job the best, that's and the job they are qualified for. So for example, an SNC is an SNC. He has to do only the SNC work to the best of his knowledge, to the best of his abilities. Physios should never step into psychologist's role or nutritionist's role. If there is one allocated to the team, you know, or if it's like the last thing I would do is to say prescribe a supplement, because that's even if I'm in the situation where there's no one involved, I would still say suggest the athlete or the patient to talk to
someone
they can talk to, and only then you are going to have the best results possible.
Yes, again. So again, the Olympic silver will not take place overnight. It requires those years of training, years of tournaments, your qualification rounds, then your wishful planning, then as you just told, all the interdisciplinary approach to whatever the athlete needs for a better performance is supposed to be done. So again, many things would be controversial. The way you approach the athlete, the way you treat them on the field is going to be quite different for each physical therapist, right?
Absolutely. And for the athlete, each athlete.
Yeah, for each athlete. So how the athlete also perceives the whole training or the treatment that has been happening to them. So how was the training a year before the Olympics started?
So I actually joined Meera about 6 months preceding to the games. So I can talk about 6 months before that, but I knew what she was up to 6 months before that. So actually, there was a lot of, like, till August 2020 or September, the loads were very low because we were under the lockdown. And she was in Patiala training at the national camp, where there was, like, very limited access to the internal facilities because they were really, you know, they only had about limited training options available. For example, there was no recovery kind of modalities are available or allowed at that time. No sauna, steam bath sessions, swimming allowed. So all that had to be, you know, it was difficult to train. And October onwards, she traveled to the US to fix her back injury or issue that she was facing. Let's not call it injury. She was not really very injured, but it was an issue that was happening. And then she went to see the squat university guys. We popular show of Dr. Aaron Hoschick. He has been a weightlifter himself and a physiotherapist now. So that becomes a very, you know, as we call it, it's a killer combination of a fantastic weightlifting physiotherapist. Or someone who understands weightlifting and someone who's a physiotherapist and someone who has very, very good knowledge in the field. So he's an immensely talented guy and really, really works very hard on his craft and keeps things very, very simple. So Meera and her coach were very, very impressed with the kind of work that they had done in a couple of months with him. And he did work on a lot of areas that Meera needed work on. And after that, February onwards, January end, I joined the team. And it was clear that we had an event in March that we had to go to. And after that, we were again going to go to his place in the US. But then because of the lockdown, I happened to go there a little late because I had to work through the visa processes and all that. So, yeah, I mean, the training wise, she would generally like it's weightlifting is a sport where you can't take any breaks because as you know, if there is like, if you slightly dip on strength, like even if you are a normal gym goer, if you don't train for a week, you can feel the like lethargy in your muscles when you start off again.
Yeah.
Even if you are a regular gym goer. And here we are talking about an Olympic bound athlete. So the muscle tension and the muscle, you know, in layman terms, the athletes and the coaches are known to call it the muscle memory or the muscle.
Yeah.
But it's basically the neurological kind of, or whatever you may call it. I mean, I don't know the better word for it, but I think it's some kind of neural firing for the muscle. That's what I understand by that.
Yes.
So it's some kind of that habituality of a muscle to really work for a particular activity. And especially because it's a power sport. It's not an endurance sport. An endurance sport, you can warm up to that activity and then sort of keep doing it for a bit of time and your muscles can fall into place. But here, you need to be extremely sharply warmed up before your first lift because it just happens in a flash. And if something goes wrong in that flash, you've had it. Like it's the game is over. And that's when it's really, really tough with weightlifting. So, so she trained almost without a single break. I mean, only Sundays and her break days, official break days were the break days to accommodate the training. That's, I mean, the loads of the training. But otherwise, there's no break. And with training, she would do a lot of prehab and rehab. And that also goes hand in hand with what you do. And she's one of the most dedicated athletes I've seen ever. I mean, I've worked with a lot of athletes in the last 7-8 years. I can clearly say that like she's probably the most dedicated athletes I've worked with. That is like it's very, very meditative to watch her train. It's, she goes in and she doesn't talk much. She just does what she has to do. And that's just, I think, why we see her on the podium.
Yes. Yeah. So again, we were discussing if the training itself, because even her techniques are quite specified ones. So I, as far as my understanding, for a weightlifting, you have many variants, the squat, lift and everything. But for her, it was a clean and clear and jerk that she was.
Snatch and clean and jerk are two Olympic weightlifting events. So basically, you have to do only, like, you have to do a snatch as part of the first drill, and the second drill is a clean and jerk. Those are the only two events that are there in the Olympic weightlifting. So you prepare for snatch and you prepare for a clean and jerk, and the total of a snatch and a clean and jerk, the best of the three that you lift, is calculated to be totaled, and then that's how they decide.
The average of that is going to be calculated as?
No, actually the total of, so if each athlete is allowed three snatches, and all the athletes complete the snatches first, and after that, all the athletes complete the clean and jerks. just a 10-minute break in between.
Yeah.
And the best of the snatches plus the best of the clean and jerks.
Okay.
Is totaled to give them the record, the total. So that's
okay.
The total that Meera lifted at the Olympics was 202 kilograms. So 87 kilo of snatch and 115 kilogram clean.
Okay. Yeah. So anyways, they would have to train separately for both.
Yeah, and absolutely.
Yeah. That's nice. So I think that that's where the squat expert, Dr. Aaron Hauschings, helped you. I mean, helped Mirabai for that matter. Immense. Yeah. So, sorry, I did a little bit of stalking on your Instagram, and then I found that you have a signed copy of Rebuilding Milo, a book written by Dr. Aaron Hauschings. So how was it actually being with them? So you worked with Dr. Aaron Hoshing, then you had the Dronacharya awardee coach, Vijay Sharma, sir. So how was it working with them?
You don't get to work with elites of that kind so often. And here I had literally the world's three best people with me, obviously Meera being one of them. Vijay Sharma coach, Vijay sir being one of them, and Aaron obviously being one of them. So it was an immensely learning experience and rewarding as well. It's not I wouldn't say it was easy. It was never easy. It was never meant to be easy. But that's the best part about it. I mean, when it gets difficult, you learn every single day. Every single day was a massive learning curve. And eventually you get used to learning that fast. And I'd done it before and I was happy to sort of be put in that position again. And it was very, very, I would say I was lucky to be in that position and equally honored at the same time. And just to give you some briefs, like, for example, I would say the coach has to be someone who keeps everyone on their toes. And that's what Vijay sir is very, very good at. And at the same time, he understands the importance of keeping the athlete in the cocoon and almost like in a safe box, you know. And for weightlifting, it's very, very important because you have to protect the athlete from getting injured at all times. It's a sport where in training, you're lifting more than 85% of one RM almost every 2 days. Like literally, or every alternate session, if I may say. Either squats or either, you know, some kind of exercise. So so it's imperial to keep the athlete injury free because that's the only way you're going to get any training and that's the only way you're going to get any performance. If that's as simple as that. And Aaron came in at a time where we knew we had to get Meera ready for the Olympics. And he had, like with his experience in this field, he was very sharp with his clinical patterns. Very, very simple. And clinical patterns came with, like his clinical patterns are very broad in the sense, if I may say, that if you present with a symptom, you know, he knows that a particular plan can work for this symptom. And it's not easy. It's not generalization. You would obviously, there's a lot of trial and error. We know that with every athlete. But with an expert, what we see is the reasoning, sort of the clinical reasoning sort of skips a lot of steps and jumps onto what seems like a very easy, eventually an easy option. But then for an experienced, for an expert to get there, it has taken a lot of years of work to actually get to that result. Whereas for a novice, it will be like it might never come back. I mean, it will take immense practice to get to where he would get to. So that experience always helped us going along the way if we had any problems. Tweaking some exercise programs for that matter. Just, you know, working on what we were working on, but he would suggest that, you know, why don't we work this way? Why don't we work that way? So to have good discussions, to sort of keep, you know, brainstorming and come up with, and again, like I said, all of us were driven by the idea that we have to get her to do whatever she can do best. including Meera, and she was up for it as well. I mean, she would never stop experimenting if that was going to benefit her. So, I mean, you need that kind of a team with you.
Yeah, exactly. So, as you just said, even Vijay Sharma sir was, as a coach, he was supposed to be protective of his athlete. So, even Meerabai would have, obviously, there is a lot of mental work that goes into achieving all of these training and pulling up yourself every time when you could not achieve something. Not just for the athlete, it is for the whole of the team, the coach, the therapists, everyone that is involved in the team. So again, we did understand whatever your learning experiences were. Yeah. So what are your takeaways for the viewers? So we are the viewers are going to be the budding physiotherapists, sometimes even the experts that are watching the interviews. So what are your takeaways that you want to give them?
I think I just want to share my experiences. There's nothing, I mean, everyone will have a different take on what they go through. For me, I think the most important thing is for working with an elite athlete like, say, Meerabai, for example, you have to completely surrender yourself to the athlete and their ecosystem. And you have to be able to do that. No matter where you come from, no matter what you do, what you've done in the past as a clinician, so many times in this field, because it's so, so competitive. I mean, that's an Olympics is as competitive as you can get. And that's when you have to literally be ready to unlearn every single thing that you've learned and just come up with a fresh approach. For a novice physio or a new physio, it's easier. For an expert or someone who's worked for a few years in some field, it's difficult. But again, that's where the more you're able to learn and the more you're able to unlearn will actually decide if you are going to be successful in that manner. And I think carrying a little bit of baggage with what you know can help, but you have to be able to sort of keep the bags away at any point of time and then just be open to ideas. And because you're working in an athlete's ecosystem, I think that's even more important. Working at your clinic versus working in an athlete's ecosystem are completely different things. There in your clinic, you are your own boss. In an athlete's ecosystem, everyone else is working in their ecosystem where the coach is literally the boss. The athlete is also in a very demanding position, and there you sort of have to play like an observer's role more than an interventionalist, because it's really like your intervention can only happen, needs to only happen if it needs to happen. Otherwise, you just watch the show and just sort of keep doing what you have to do. That's it. If there's no intervention, then you've had a great day.
So yeah, there are, as far as I understand, whatever you have told, there are two ways a sports physiotherapist can work. First is the prevention of the injury itself. Yes. And the next, when you are in the field, it is good that you are not supposed to intervene. I mean, it's a good day if you have not intervened, as you just said.
Yeah, I mean, so if you've not had a very, you shouldn't be able to manage pains, aches and pains too often, because then that's something that you have. I'm not saying you're going wrong somewhere, but then there's something that, I mean, the athlete should never get to a point where they are missing multiple sessions because of pain.
Yeah.
And the coach will literally be sitting on your head if there is pain, because it's very simple for the coaches. I mean, I shouldn't have any pain. Why should my athlete have any pain? He shouldn't have any pain.
So yeah, going back to the same thing, your work is prevention, and if there is pain and if there should be an immediate rehabilitation, again, they shouldn't miss too many training sessions. It shouldn't actually interfere with their performance as well. So again, as you mentioned earlier, that being a sports physiotherapist, you have a lot of basics that you are supposed to carry with you. So that begins with your anatomy, physiology, the kinesiology that you have learned, the basics of musculoskeletal assessment that you know, and analyzing the whole sport itself. biomechanical analysis itself is going to help you understand a lot of things of the athlete. Yeah. It was really nice having you, Dr. Alap. We hope to have a few more educational sessions from you in the future. And all the best to your athletes, all the best to you, all the best to Gold Quest, Olympic Gold Quest. So, yes, this is Dr. Nikita Dodwad signing off. See you all again.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for being here.